Welcome to Sermon Brainwave with me, Matt Skinner.
And me, Karoline Lewis.
And me, Rolf Jacobson.
And me, Joy J. Moore.
The text for the first Sunday of Christmas, which falls on December 27th, 2020, are these: Isaiah 61:10 through 62:3, Psalm 148, Galatians 4:4 to 7, and Luke 2:22 through 40. Happy third day of Christmas, friends.
And to you.
This is what, three skater skating, or
three turtle doves, or is it two turtle doves?
I don't know.
Two turtle doves.
And three something.
I get bored with that song after five.
My gym did an awesome workout last week where we did the 12 days of Christmas, but it was like a different, we did like 12 burpees, 11 jumping jacks, 10, French hens, three French hens.
I was right, yay!
Three French presses then, two Arnold presses. It was awesome, it's great.
That's great.
Yeah.
But we're gonna talk about, I guess it's circumcision. Already Jesus is 8 days old. And and they offer a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. So there's a lot of fowl taking place in today's podcast. But this is a great scene. I mean, this is, you can't do better than Luke 1 to 2 for biblical narrative in general. And this scene where we meet Anna and Simeon, it's a great text. And some people don't know it because, you know, it's post-Christmas, but—
Because no one's gonna be in worship anyway.
I disagree this year just because it's so much easier to attend worship in your jammies.
And your cup of coffee.
So I have a feeling this year will be a better attended first Sunday of Christmas than most years. I could be wrong, but that's my wager.
I'm going to vote with you, Matt.
And the hard part is you can't sing the way you used to sing. So you might as well preach a really good sermon on the, ready? Nunc Dimittis.
I thought it was Nunc Dimittis.
I think that's in England. I think here on this side of the pond, it's Nunc Dimittis.
Really?
I don't know.
Oh,
I have no idea.
I like the other side of the pond better for that.
I took Latin in seventh and eighth grade and got in a lot of trouble for fooling around in that class. But anyway.
Well, you're right, Matt. It is a great text, and there's so much here. I just did a little workshop on the Christmas texts couple weeks ago with some pastors. And when we got to this text, just so much with regard to the themes of Christmas, but also this COVID Christmas that I thought were really powerful. And one thing about this text that I wanted to start with is the witness of Simeon and Anna. And the way in which, how is it that we might invite our listeners to embody or utter their praise? That this is a cause for praise. This is a cause for celebration. And what Luke does here is really offer an attestation, I think, of the variety of witnesses that we've had in this story, like from the shepherds, and now we have Simeon and Anna, the prophetess. And really that's an invitation for all of us to imagine how is it that we are going to witness, or how is it that we are going to testify to this event? What will be our response to Christmas? And the Sunday after Christmas, and then particularly in times when our usual sort of exercises of praise and celebration they're different this year. How might we follow the model of Anna and Simeon and think about them as witnesses to witness is one direction I would maybe take.
I like that a lot, especially when you consider who they are in particular, considering their ages and their faithfulness. That's how it's been demonstrated that for Luke, these people's piety is just off the charts, it appears, for both of them. They represent, or they symbolize people of Israel who have been waiting and who are ready for the Messiah to come. And in some ways that speaks back to Advent. Why do we spend all this time in Advent talking about waiting and hoping Because then when you get to the fulfillment of the promise, you respond like these two respond, right? They become this model for witness. And that response is praise, just full-throated praise. And it's also a recognition that the promise has been kept. And will have implications still going forward. So for Simeon, it's this, I can die now, quite literally, right? The promise has been fulfilled to me. I think Anna as well is in that position of, you know, expecting good things to come. And they both can exhale, breathe a sigh of relief. But in the nunc dimittis, Simeon also sings of how important or how grand this is going to be moving forward for the whole world. So it's very personal for them, but it's also global in its outlook and future in its outlook.
One of the things I learned from you, Matt, over the years working with these Lucan texts, excuse me, in chapters 1 and 2, is that how often the Holy Spirit is the one prophesying through. And so although in Luke Acts, most people relate the promise in Joel, remember the promise in Joel that in Joel 2, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Sons and daughters shall prophesy. Old men shall dream dreams. Young men shall see visions, male and female. I think most people correlate that with Acts too, but I think it's here also, because what do you have? You have the Holy Spirit now guiding Simeon, and Anna is a prophet. And so you've got the male and female, the old here, and before you had others, so that the Holy Spirit, you know, I think once you point it out to me, it just jumps out of the off the page throughout these two chapters. And so I might correlate it back with that text. You might even replace the Isaiah text if that's for your reading for this particular Sunday to note that. For those who don't speak Latin, right, the nunc dimittis is the now you are dismissing, right? Mm-hmm. In verse 29, mm-hmm. Which some traditions use liturgically in Lent, strangely. Mm-hmm. Well, it's because it doesn't say Alleluia as the response to the gospel. But Karoline would use it liturgically this Sunday.
Well, I might, but I love that. I'm glad you pointed that out, Rolf, with regard to the Spirit, because you have three times it's mentioned here in these verses with regard to Simeon, and that it's that Spirit that is guiding and present. And if you were going to go that direction in your preaching point or focus, how you could carry that forward into Luke and just show how really at almost every turn there is a reference to the Spirit for Jesus. Jesus, guided by the Spirit, went into the desert. Jesus, guided by the Spirit. And so just to show that this is all happening with the promise and the power of the Holy Spirit. And so it, which is, I think it's a kind of a really an interesting and perhaps important focus for a Sunday after Christmas, where we're so focused on Jesus, and then we're like, oh yeah, God's a part of this too. And then where's the Holy Spirit in Christmas? and so how we can think about, help people think about the activity and the promise and presence and power of the Holy Spirit. And then, like you said, Rolf, connecting that back to the conception of Mary, you know, Mary's conception. So this is all part of the narrative. It's all part of the story. I think could be a great preaching point.
I think we've noted some really powerful different directions to go in. And as I was reading it, I was struck with the question of, when the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, it's a ritual. It is a practice that has been carried out and passed down. And as we began just talking about whether or not this would be a high worship time, I wonder if this might be the time to reestablish or to establish what would be new rituals for family gathering, because we've gone through a year which seemed that we have really been in waiting. We have really been in need of what would be good news, what would be something that we were anticipating, something to come along, something to be better. And how do we respond in a recognition that God is in the midst of all of this? And how do we do that among the people that we have actually been with, our family, the people that are in the house with us, the folks that we actually have been able to gather with through this quarantine season of this past year? So I just wonder if there might be a way to lift up this idea of establishing some type of ritual so that we don't forget the strain of this year, but that in remembering it, we remember it with the praise and gladness of God in the midst that this particular story bears witness to.
Yeah, and one of the things about this, you know, this is of course Mary's purification according to Leviticus 12, and you know, one of the overlooked, you mentioned the fowl, Matt, earlier about the turtle doves and the pigeons, but that is, I mean, it's a you know, brief reference that you could just kind of skip over, but what that gives witness to is where Jesus comes from and where does Jesus exist? Jesus' family. Jesus lives in the economic margins. Jesus lives, and Jesus will give witness to that in his sermon at Nazareth, that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to bring sight to the blind, let the oppressed go free, that this solidarity with the poor. And blessed are the poor in Luke's Beatitudes. So it is a reference to that reality of Jesus' economic status.
Carolyn, can we connect the dots for people that might not know why you're drawing that conclusion?
Oh, well, this would be the turtle doves and the young pigeons would be the offering that someone who of less economic status would be able to offer with regard to Mary's purification after giving birth. So that's the connection. Right. And so there's something in that too of where does Jesus' family and where does Jesus locate himself? He locates himself in those margins, not in the elite center, but in the, and you think about the whole cast of characters that we have heard in Luke 1 and 2 of the shepherds and Elizabeth, barren Elizabeth. And so that I think there's something in that as well, building off of your attention to ritual joy, that this also says something about who Jesus' ministry will be for. And of course, Mary has also given witness to that in the Magnificat already, that you have looked with favor upon me, and how is it God could regard me? And maybe that is a question for a lot of people right now. Does God still regard me? Does God still see me? When so much has changed, and particularly when I'm not able to, act out my faith as I have usually, is my faith still valid? Does God still recognize my belief when I'm not able to go to church and I'm not able to do the things that I have always done to embody my belief in God?
I really appreciate that recognition that Luke's cast of characters, to use your line, Caroline, is going to draw our attention to this difference all the way through the gospel. This record is going to recognize women and men. It's going to recognize the marginalized and those who are supposedly the center of the culture. Matt and Rolf in different ways have called out that this is not a new thing that God is doing, that Anna and Simeon are those of the older generation who have long awaited this promise to be fulfilled, and it is being passed on to the generation now and to come. And as Rolf called out, you know, this is the promise that God's spirit would be upon men and women, upon that old will and young will have dreams and visions. And so not to get lost that this is a not to lose the fact that this is what God has always been doing, God has always been about, but watching for the cast of characters that Luke will dramatically point out throughout the entire gospel that leans into this both and all included. And if we even take it to the second edition and go to the book of Acts, that God's spirit is truly poured out upon all. I think, Matt, you made the statement at the beginning that what was local is actually global.
Yeah, I want to say one quick thing, and then we can move on. Caroline was nice enough to correct me without being really obvious. She was correcting me that this is not the circumcision. This is actually the story of Mary's purification, which means Jesus is like 39 or 40 days old. So, because verse 21's not here where Jesus is circumcised on the eighth day. I said that. I'm an idiot. Don't send me emails telling me that because I recognize that. All right.
Well, I have, okay, two more things, and then we can go on. The other thing you might want to do is sit on verse 30. For my eyes have seen your salvation. That is a beautiful entry into helping people think about salvation is located in the birth of Jesus. And not that Jesus' death is not a part of that, but that there's what is salvation here, according to Simeon. And then also just recognizing that Christmas is not just like, this is all fine and wonderful because you have the reference to this is a sign that will be opposed. And indeed, Jesus is rejected in Nazareth, and the women at the tomb see the empty tomb, and the disciples say, "Yeah, well, that's a load of you know what." So there's that element here too, that what has happened is going to be opposed by many, and how does that change how we think about our witness, and how does that help us think about what Christmas means and looks like going forward? Okay, that's it. I'm done. Isaiah.
I'm going to take that, Caroline, your first point in terms of turning straight to Isaiah. I looked at this and saw glimpses of the garments of salvation and where you were saying to linger in verse 30 and what is that salvation? What does it mean? And I know Rolf was suggesting looking at Joel as an Old Testament reading, but I think also that this Isaiah 61 can actually bring us into what you were lifting up, Caroline, in terms of how do we see salvation? And salvation is not just at the end, at the crucifixion, at the end of Jesus' life, but it is the recognition of the God, of God being with us, of God coming to be among us. And what does God do except for making us surrounded, covered by God's presence of healing, God's presence of making right again, God's presence of giving to us what we have need of. And this text talks about the robe of righteousness, the garments of salvation, the adornment of jewels. And what does it mean to play with that in terms of we've just celebrated the gifts of Christmas, and here the God of creation has given us all that we need. How do we glimpse that as salvation?
I really like that, making that connection, if that's the direction that you decide to go with the Luke text, of making that connection to Isaiah, besides the fact that I'm not anticipating getting any jewels for my birthday or for Christmas. So I'm hoping maybe this will like do something for that. Anything
your
else
colleagues
on that?
Here will keep that in mind when your birthday comes up. Note, friends.
Anything else about Isaiah?
It's A couple of things about Isaiah. First of all, just to note that this is a continuation of the text that Jesus preaches on in Luke 4. So we're going to have probably, I haven't looked ahead, I assume that the first part of Isaiah 61 is the Old Testament reading when we get to Luke 4. But this actually, this is the deep dive stuff for a Bible study, not for a sermon probably, but just for your own preparation, just note that. Go back and read how it leads into that, how the earlier part leads into this. And I actually think 1 through 11 is one prophetic message. And then the divisions, the chapter divisions of the Bible, in this case, get it right. They don't often get it, I mean, they don't always get it right. And then 62:1 starts another message. So this Old Testament reading clips the end of one pericope with the start of the next one. So it's a little confusing who the I is that is speaking, but especially then notice for Jerusalem's sake that this is about, it's very confusing poetry because you've got two different oracles, but then so early on you get the garments of righteousness that you're talking about then, but then you get the stuff about the earth and about the city. And the city itself then shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord, a royal diadem. I'm looking up one thing in Hebrew as I'm talking, which is hard to do when you're this tired.
You keep looking, and I'll just say, I appreciate the fact that Rolf added verses and reminded us to put this back in context. Thank you very much. Did you find it yet?
Yeah, I just, I am. So in verse 3, at the end, you shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord. The you there is feminine, meaning it's the city that the prophet is talking, or God here is speaking and is talking about the city. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord. It's that image of Jerusalem as the embodiment of the whole people of God. So the other thing just to point out is the language about in verse 11 at the end of the first of the two messages that are pasted together here, the earth brings forth its shoots. That leads nicely into the psalm, which is about nature. So that two of these, a different direction to go would be to connect this to creation. And since my commentary on Psalm 148 is already on the website where I do all that work, I won't repeat myself here.
You mentioned me in your commentary. That's so nice of you. I appreciate that, Rolf. But I have to give credit where credit is due. And I wish I had said that, but that's Carl Reiner, who the quote is, "Some people like snow. I find it to be an unnecessary freezing of water," which I totally agree with Carl Reiner. So that is exactly right. But thanks for mentioning me.
Well, you're the one that taught me the quotation. So for me, it's you that said it.
And most of our audience right now is saying, who is Carl Reiner? But anyway.
I do want to point I really appreciate the commentary by Michael Chan, as he notes that the true prophet stands in the gap, and that is exactly what this particular piece is doing. And if we ever needed a voice that stands in the gap, today our culture and society and church very much needs a voice that stands in the gap.
I think going back to the psalm, I like that connection, Rolf. And then, you know, if you go the direction of praise with Simeon and Anna and talk about that response, I mean, you know, this is here's the wording that you can use to talk about, you know, the importance of praise. And then I think also the way in which this psalm gives witness to a kind of a cosmic reality of Jesus' birth, that the whole world responds to this. It's not just an individual or the church as it becomes the church, but the entire earth, the entire universe recognizes what has happened in the birth of Jesus. And I think that would be a lovely direction to take to take a sermon on this Sunday of what is the meaning of Christmas.
Even if you don't preach on the psalm, I would say at the very beginning of a service, if you're employing some of these hymns that Rolf picks up, it would be really helpful just to show people or to offer notes on the hymns to help people see the ways in which all of nature is called into this. I love Galatians 4 as a Christmas text. This is about as close as Paul ever gets to recognizing Mary.
Way to go, Paul.
Born of a woman, and then kind of moves on. And so the text is probably selected because of the reference to Jesus' birth, but I think it's such an interesting Christmas text because of the reference to adoption, which is incredibly important as maybe an underdeveloped or under-recognized kind of metaphor of salvation that Paul uses. And as well, there's reference again to the Spirit here. So that same Spirit that moves in Anna and Simeon and others is also bearing witness in ourselves, in our ability to call God parent. And that's worth spending some time on, especially if you want to dig into what did adoption mean in Paul's world, and how does that confer things like identity and dignity, but also things like an inheritance and to be an heir, and the way in which status was carried on in that world. There's problems with that, of course, but it also shows that to be adopted is utterly life-changing in Paul's context. I mean, it probably isn't any context, but in that context has a way of transporting somebody almost instantly across various kind of status categories in that world.
I appreciate that lifting up, Matt, and find this a powerful Christmas reading as well. It kind of circles back, as Karoline began us talking, and you did as well, of talking about who the people are that are addressed in the Lucan text, and this recognition of the marginalized to need to be adopted, need to have the inheritance shared, extended to you. I think is an important thing for us to recognize and for a preacher to linger on. A question I think that we might want to explore is what is the equivalence of an inheritance today? Do we really experience a shared blessing, or are we so individualistic that this is really an ancient or foreign idea where we are the people who need to make a name for ourselves or a way for ourselves? This is a reminder that we are in this in community, that we need to be in this together, and that ultimately the blessing or promise that was given to Israel was never about Israel or for Israel, but it was always for all of God's creation, human and the cosmos. And this is a way to ask that question in terms of our own individual lives, but to recognize that it is a community that we need to be a part of. And as I said at the beginning, maybe it is a community we need to recover.